In part one of Boards on the Water, we took a look at how the sport of water skiing developed from a daredevil act into an international recreational pastime and multidisciplined competitive sport. In part three, we'll take a look at barefooting, show skiing, how water ski products are made, and talk with people and families that have made water skiing part of their lifestyle. But first, in this episode, we'll take a look at various towed water sports where a person doesn't stand on a traditional narrow ski, but instead rides a wider board in a kneeling, sitting, or sideways standing position. This is Boards on the Water. Kneeboarding began in the 1970s when Southern California surfers began riding short, homemade boards on their knees while being pulled behind boats. The first commercial introduction of the kneeboard was by Mike Murphy and Bud Holtz, who produced the fiberglass knee ski, while John Taylor invented the blow-molded plastic glide slide. Neither product saw large commercial success. However, a water skier, Danny Churchill, found some financing, bought glide slide, and redesigned the board. Flattening out the bottom and widening the tail greatly reduced drag on the board. The new rotational molded board was renamed the Hydro Slide and achieved great success. In the late 80s, guys like Mario Fassa and Ted Bevilacqua were tearing up the water at contests, demos, in videos, and as part of the pro water skiing tour being shown on ESPN. This exposure helped fuel the popularity of the kneeboard. Over 1 million kneeboards have been sold, and their popularity is due in part to the ease with which they can be ridden and the types of tricks that can be accomplished on them. Kneeboards employ a semi-symmetrical design with the tip and tails to allow the board to be ridden both forwards and backwards. Typical dimensions are 56 inches long and 21 inches wide. Construction may be roto-molded plastic or compression-molded fiberglass over foam, which can produce a lighter, thinner board. A contoured foam pad with a strap helps hold the board to the rider during aerial tricks, and a smooth, gently curved bottom allows boards to spin easily on the water and land softly from jumps. Some boards may have retractable fins. Variations in rail design and bottom contour largely determine the edging and turning characteristics of the board. In Lake Placid, Florida, a group of four of the best kneeboarders in the country have grown up riding together and pushing each other to new levels.
Lisa Piper. I love the kneeboard because you're always out on the lake, hot day, cold water, so much fun. My friends that I ride with and train with are Patrick Kemery, Jared Bolin, and John Hale, and we always get together. And it's different because I'm the girl in the group, but I feel at home because they're like my family, and we grew up together, so. It's been a family sport. My cousins and my aunts and uncles used to compete, and they got me into it at a young age, about 2. I used to sit on my dad's lap, and we used to ride around the lake.
My name is John Hale. Well, I was 6 years old, and my dad decided to take me out kneeboarding, and I was on a yellow hydro slide, and he helped me get up. He was out there, and he held me up on the kneeboard, and he told my mom to go, and she pulled me through.
My name's Jared Bolin. I've been kneeboarding since I was maybe 2 years old.
Patrick Kimmery. Well, kneeboarding for me started about when I was 4 years old. My dad put me on a big, thick hydro slide and held me on there so I could keep my balance, and just told the boat driver to go, and he just said, hold on.
Kneeboards are often the easiest way to introduce children and beginners to towed water sports. They can be pulled off a beach, climbed onto while planing off, or even started from a strapped-in position. Because the rider's center of gravity is very low and there's a large planing surface, the kneeboard is relatively easy to spin on the water, jump off the wake, and maneuver in the air. This has spawned a variety of fun and exciting tricks.
Well, I like to do a lot of tricks, like the fives, the 540s, the layouts, the rolls, 360s. Basically, spins are my thing.
Basically, you know, wake O, wake back, wake fronts, TikTok grabs, basic wake tricks, and I like to mess around with the surface a little bit.
I could do back rolls from the left and the right. I could do wake O backs from both sides, arrow backs, TikToks, surface tricks, pretty much basic stuff.
My favorite trick to do is a front roll back.
The layout, just the feeling that I can fly through the air like 10 feet up.
When you get tired of riding alone, it's always fun to share the water with a friend.
Me and Dad, we got out there and we had a good, you know, soul session, you know, just going out and spraying each other and fighting each other, and I won.
Me and Jared, we've rode doubles for a long time. For me and Jared, it's always been about like pushing each other, you know, playing tag or playing a game of horse. I mean, he's older than me, so I've always been trying to like go as big as he can or copy his tricks or just follow like moving up how he does.
Although wakeboards have become more popular, there are still a lot of folks who are out there skiing on their knees. Sold under trade names such as Sky Ski and Air Chair, the Hydrofoil gets its name from an airplane-like assembly of two small wings connected by a keel called the foil. The foil is mounted on a strut typically 39 inches below a double-wide ski, which at 51 inches is about 3/4 as long as a regular ski. The rider sits on a cushioned seat on top of a sturdy base and is secured to the ski with a lap belt and foot straps. The ski is compression-molded fiberglass over foam, and the wing, strut, and seat base are made of aluminum. Performance is determined by changes in foil design. Unlike all other water skis and boards, the Hydrofoil does not plane on the water, but rides above it using lift generated from the wing. Because they have less drag, Hydrofoils have been used on watercraft for over 100 years, with Italian inventor Enrico Forlanini creating the first Hydrofoil boat in 1906. Alexander Graham Bell and Casey Graham set a speed record with an improved design in the Hydrodrome 4. Hydrofoils were first used in water sports when Walter Woodward attached hydrofoils to water skis in the 1960s. Hydrofoilers not only glide over the water, but use the lift of the wing to jump up to 20 feet in the air. Pros such as Gino Yockler and Jake Bradley use that airtime to perform spectacular tricks. So what attracted people to this unique sport, and how did the hydrofoil come to be in this form?
I got into hydrofoiling back in 1990. I saw this long-haired hippie guy, Mike Murphy, out on the lake in San Antonio, Texas, and I was like, that is the coolest thing I've ever seen. And later on that summer, I had the opportunity to try one. A friend of mine had one, and I was hooked ever since.
I got started in hydrofoiling back in 1995 when I saw this cool video of a guy named Mike Murphy on it. And I'd never seen anything like it before. And we were skiers, and he was riding on top of the water. And I said, that has got to be for us.
So, who is Mike Murphy? Mike is a blend of athlete, inventor, entrepreneur, and promoter who has participated in all aspects of towed water sports. Considered a true innovator, Mike Murphy was honored at the AWSEF Hall of Fame with an award of distinction for his contributions to water skiing.
Basically, what a hydrofoil is an airplane. Water is like 700 times denser than air. So in designing this thing, we scaled down an airplane 700 times, knowing how much weight it was gonna carry, the speeds of going, and it really worked really well. So an attempt to make a kneeboard ride smooth, I hooked up with a gentleman called Bob Woolley, and together him and I made a hydrofoil that mounted to a kneeboard. The problem with that is when you ride a hydrofoil, there's no drag, you can ride it for hours. And when you're kneeling, it shuts the blood off to your ankles. And we were riding this thing for hours at a time and wrecking our ankles. So then we made a set of water skis so you could sit, like the old sit ski you could sit on. And that worked much better. But the problem was when you jump, the water would hit you between the legs so hard to try to come out your ears. So we pushed the two skis together, made one ski. That was great. But then when you jump it, you'd fall, you'd come off of it. And I got some stitches in my arm here, so we put a seat belt on it and then added foot straps to it. So it's just, the hydrofoil was really metamorphosized from a kneeboard, and there were a whole bunch of people involved. So that's how it really happened. That's the real story.
It doesn't take a lot of muscles because it's more of a balance thing. So once you get the balance position, you do a lot of tricks. You can jump as high as you want. It takes a dip and then you're up.
Basically what you have is like putting your hand out the window of a car, air blows it up and down. It's very simple. If you lean back, which way are you gonna go? It's gonna push you up. If you lean forward, it's gonna push you down. Now you have the big strut that the wing's attached to. Think of that as a rudder. If I aim my knees left, I'm gonna go left. If I aim my knees right, I'm gonna go right. So water pushes you left and right with your knees, pushes you down and up, basically by the manipulation of your shoulders.
When it comes to controlling a hydrofoil, there is maybe no one better than world champion Gino Yockler.
So there's a lot of tricks you can do on the hydrofoil. There's your basic inverts, back rolls are where usually people start. Gainers, that's another trick a lot of people start with, and those are usually where your head goes backwards or sideways. And then of course there's front flips, where you can go all the way out the front, complete somersault forward, and those are big air tricks typically. You're looking at probably 20 feet plus that you can go on a front flip. Then you have your more technical maneuvers where you do a 360 spin. You actually have to spin all the way around and of course land it without taking a terrible crash. And then there's the full twisting invert, usually called the Mobius, and you take that actually from geometry. It's a mathematical term.
Sharing the air with Gino is high-flying Jake Bradley.
Jake Bradley, he is the big air guy. You want to learn how to go big, you talk to Jake Bradley. He does a lot of different tricks, including the ones I've spoke of. He can also do another maneuver. It's similar to an air railing on a wakeboard. So your body goes completely behind you. You get stretched out, and then he pulls it back. An amazing rider. He's very smooth. And of course, he's always going to get the best style points. Back in 1996, I set a world record for the most flips. It was just after Mike Murphy did 708 flips, and you know, that was a big number. Did it in 2.5 hours. I did 1,416 flips, took me 4.5 hours, and I was exhausted afterwards. That was this guy, Bill Von Zaber, 41 years old. He's like, I think I can break that record that Gino set, you know, 12 years ago. So he goes out, 6.5 hours later, it's actually 6 hours and 26 minutes, I believe, 140 miles, he did 3,058 flips. And I mean, I'm bowing down to the guy, bowing down up top. He's not with us anymore. He died 2 months after that, but what an amazing feat.
My wife and I, we started hydrofoiling in 95, and we've been married 35 years, and we finally found a sport that we enjoy together, and she's got bad knees. When I first saw the videotape, I says, I found it for you.
There's not very many sports that you don't use your legs, and with this sport, paralyzed people could do it. So you can point your legs in the direction you want to go if you want to do that, but if you don't have your legs, you can just turn your head, and the hydrofoil will follow you. So for me, it's the perfect sport for me.
The reason it was designed back in the 90s was because by noon, all the lakes were just choppy. And regular three-event water skiing, wakeboarding, kneeboarding, barefoot, and you were done. You can't ski in soup. So they come up with this, so now we can just raise above the water of those lakes, go right over the top of it, and continue to enjoy what we're doing.
Once you are above the water, several things happen. About 90% of the drag goes out of the rope because you don't have the wetted surface of the ski. And the second thing is, you're above the rough water, so it'd kind of be like flying an airplane over a mountain range. You're not going to feel it, so you get a smooth ride.
When you're riding a hydrofoil, to me it feels like you're riding a flying carpet, and that's what the addicting feeling is. It's kind of our fun thing that we do. I mean, once you start and once you get it, it's kind of addicting.
The reason we like hydrofoiling is it's a little more forgiving on the crashes. You can do the sport at 15 miles an hour. I like 27. Most people are in the 20s, and that's not a real bad crash. You can enjoy it and not be a muscular person. I was 45 when I started hydrofoiling, and I'm 60 years old now. I've seen people from 5 years old on up into Mary Murphy in her late 80s riding a hydrofoil.
I started hydrofoiling when I was 43. I'm now 57. You don't have to have a lot of muscles.
Something that we enjoy doing together. She drives for me, I drive for her. We don't need anybody else. We got the mirror, and it's wonderful to have your soulmate be your partner and your driver, and vice versa.
Each year, hydrofoilers of all ages and abilities gather for some spring flying at the Florida Fly-In.
Started it in 2000. It all started out on a little hoot, people egging us on, and we've had a lot of fun for the last 10 years. Other fly-ins have grown out from it.
When we do the fly-ins, to us, it's like a family reunion. And we enjoy all the people that come. We have people that come from Switzerland, Canada, Mexico. 1 year it was 5 countries and 18 states. We had up to 150 people at one time. So we get anywhere from 75 people to 150 people that come to our fly-in. We have the biggest fly-in usually because we're in April, the water's 80 degrees, the weather's nice. You write on the email that the water and the weather is really nice, and people come from all over.
There's no competition, it's just plain fun, and everybody helps each other. No matter what level you're at, if a pro comes in and you're just starting for the first day, he embraces you as a fellow hydrofoiler, and fly-ins are just great as a family reunion. We love going to them all. We'll be right back.
Wakeboarding, wake skating, and wake surfing all involve riding in a sideways stance as opposed to the feet pointing forward as in skiing. These board sports combine elements of other board sports such as snowboarding and skateboarding with water skiing, but the root of all three is surfing. In the 1960s, the sport of surfing surged in the popular consciousness, receiving attention in popular media through movies and in the music of such groups as Jan and Dean and the Beach Boys. The romantic lifestyle of sun and surf made youth throughout the country want to run to the nearest beach and catch a wave. On summer vacations and spring breaks, many kids gave surfing a try and found they loved it. The problem is surfing requires an ocean, and most folks don't have one of those. So some surfers began riding their boards on lakes and rivers by getting pulled behind a boat.
We used to use kids' plastic surfboards and surf behind the boat, and then we started putting foot straps in them. We found several glass boards that were of a small variety. This is actually a skim board from Maui that had no foot straps on it, and we'd surf behind the boat and catch some air. So then we started hand shaping our own glass boards and even incorporating windsurfer foot straps into them. The windsurfer foot straps allowed us to go and catch a lot more air.
Two guys in San Diego, Jimmy Finn and Jimmy Redmond, developed and promoted the first commercially successful surf-style board for use behind a boat. It was called the Skurfer. Like kneeboards, at the time the Skurfer was roto-molded out of plastic, a less costly process than the glass and foam that regular surfboards employed. Up in the Seattle area and out in Hawaii, guys like Eric Perez and Ken Bernard were looking to make boards more responsive and lighter using compression molding, the technique used to make water skis.
August 23rd, 1990, the first compression molded board was molded. This is the actual first board. Some of the writing's gone away on it, but you can see where the date and the time is still on it. But August 23rd, 1990, 11:38 Pacific Standard Time, 9 pounds, 0 ounces. Oh, and it was under a 3/4 moon, by the way. So this is board one for a compression molded wakeboard. That's not to be confused with a Skurfer. That is a rotocast foam core board that's much lighter in the water. This board is neutral buoyancy like a water ski. You can sink it down into the water. And of the first 7 prototypes, there's 3 of them sitting right here. We had nothing for accessories back then, so we'd take surfboard fins and cut T-bolts into them, bolt them into the deck. You can see measurements on all these boards where we move stuff, and just trying different combinations because we really didn't know what direction we were going to go. And back at that point, it was actually called a ski board instead of a wakeboard. The word wakeboard came in a little bit after that when they decided that it wasn't ski boarding like a Skurfer ski board, it was a wakeboard, which was a completely different sport, which was the next generation of what was happening.
The ability to get air and do impressive tricks would make wakeboarding the fastest growing and most popular of all towed water sports. Time in the air translates to bigger, more complex tricks. The desire to get big air would drive innovation in technique, equipment, and even in the design of the boats, indelibly changing the towed water sports industry in the process. The wakeboard evolved from the ski board with the introduction of the twin tip design. Construction is resin and fiberglass compression molded onto a foam core. Both bindings are mounted perpendicular to the board, allowing it to be ridden in either direction. Length is typically between 50 and 57 inches, with the width ranging from 12 inches at the tip to 17 inches in the middle. Both ends are slightly turned up. This is called rocker and affects the speed of the board, the pop off the wake, and how it lands from a jump. Fins on the end of the board, along with the shape of the edges, determine how a board turns and tracks. Bindings have also evolved from straps and bungee cords to low wrap boots, to high wrap boots, to now full boots. Binding design must balance performance, safety, and comfort, and ideally provide for an easy entry, exit, and adjustment of tightness and shock absorption. The goal is to keep the rider firmly attached to the board while flipping and spinning through the air, and still allow the feet to release in a fall. Riders began to adjust their stance around from both feet angled forward to toes angled apart, known as duck. Much like skateboards and snowboards, which also had evolved from directional designs, a twin-tip design with a duck stance allowed the board to be ridden in either direction. This change in stance allowed the rider to squat and edge hard up and off the wake like a jump ramp. In the search for bigger air, riders began making innovations in other equipment. They began by adding weight in the form of water-filled bags to make the wake behind the boat bigger. A non-stretch rope attached to a tower mounted on the boat allowed the riders to edge harder, pop from the wake higher, and gain more time in the air. Built-in ballast tanks and towers are now standard items on a wakeboard boat. Riders were going higher and farther, giving them more time to spin and flip while in the air. As riders began to invent new tricks, it was only natural that organized competitions would soon follow. But the sport began to define itself as something different than water skiing. Slalom was eliminated as self-expression through freestyle tricks, and style took precedent over raw athleticism. Next, as the sport continued to grow, competitions that had strict point definitions like trick skiing gave way to scoring that allowed for falls and encouraged riders to try new maneuvers. As the sport quickly grew, magazines and videos dedicated to wakeboarding would highlight the stylistic and social aspects of the sport and popularize many of the riders on TV coverage on ESPN2, which was beginning to cover extreme sports, and that would inspire many new riders and fuel the sport's growth. One rider who has seen the sport change is Sean Murray. Competing since 1995, he's the only rider ever to hold world, pro tour, and national champion titles at once. Whether riding in a competition, for a video, or just for fun, Sean has always brought a stylish flair to his tricks. He has also been a big influence on other riders through his coaching, instructional videos, and video game.
Well, I was born out in Southern California, started water skiing for fun with the family back when I was probably about 8 years old. Really started getting into it when I moved to St. Louis, Missouri, onto Lake St. Louis when I was 12, and that's when about the skurfer came out. That's where the sport really started, was a skurfer. In the early 90s, like 91, 92, I saw Darren Shapiro on Hot Summer Nights. That was ESPN's late night show where we could actually see the water ski tour, and the wakeboarders were just starting to compete on it, and I saw Darren do a Rayleigh on there. And that's where you do the layout, the flying thing that people call it, the Superman. And when I first saw that on TV, I saw him do a Rayleigh and then an air front flip. That's where he does a flip without the wake. When I saw that, I was like, that is awesome, I want to do that. And I really thought it was cool. And that's when I really started to get that love for the sport.
Another rider who holds national, worlds, and pro titles and changed the face of the sport for female riders is Dallas Friday.
I started wakeboarding when I was 12 years old, almost 13. I did gymnastics prior, and I quit that, and I wanted to do another sport, and I was always like active and bouncing off the walls, and he told me to try wakeboarding, and I tried it, and I loved it, and haven't turned back since. I think one thing I really love about wakeboarding, and that makes me kind of successful and brought me to who I am, is I love competing, and I enjoy almost every aspect of it. I find it motivating. It pushes me to become better and set goals for myself. And, you know, I get to travel the world and meet other people and their cultures. And, you know, it never gets old. It's always, you want to learn something new, or you want to beat that person, or, you know, you lose a contest. And that was the changing point when you decided, okay, it's time to really, really get serious. Definitely feel like I've become a role model to, you know, young female riders and girls, and it's an honor to just have people look up to me, and nice to know that someone, you know, appreciates and you know, enjoys what you do. And I try to always keep a positive attitude.
As wakeboarding evolved, riders began grabbing their tricks and poking their boards to add a bit of style to it all. Grabs with names like nose, tail, mute, indie, method, stalefish, roast beef, and many more would make even a basic jump more stylish. As riders went bigger, basic tricks like spins, back rolls, front flips, and tantrums would become the genesis of more complex tricks with some wild names.
The way that tricks are kind of created in our sport, and every time we think that everything has been done that can be done, something else is figured out. And kind of the way that we go about it, just as a rider, you first learn to go out and jump the wake. So you learn, okay, I need to go from the left side to the right side. And then eventually you say, well, okay, I want to see if I can flip while doing that. And if you can do the flip, then you try to add a 180 while you're doing the flip. And if you can do a flip with 180, then you get up into the air and you figure out how to do the 360 with a flip. And a lot of those we call mobs. A flip with a full spin is called a mob. Sometimes you pass the handle. Sometimes you throw the rope over your head. So you're kind of spinning with the rope in one hand. Then eventually if you can do it with a 360, you try it with a 540. And like one trick that I was out there doing today, we call it a crow five. And where that comes from, the first person who does a trick gets to name it. So we have all these weird names, and I think I named the crow five, and it was a while ago. So I was the first one to do it as far as I can remember. And it comes from a toe side front roll with a front side 180. That means you're going toe side, cutting into the wake, and you do a front roll. That means just straight kind of over the handlebars almost. And if you do a 180 with that front roll, it's called a scarecrow. A lot of people just call it a crow. So we've been doing crow mobs, which is a front roll with a front side 360. And one day I was out riding with a buddy of mine and said, well, let's try it with a 540. And eventually made it. And so instead of coming up with some kind of weird name, I just called it a crow five because it went 540 and it's from a scarecrow. So I called it a crow five. There's lots of crazy names out there. We have Whirly Bird and Lorelei we talked about, and Tootsie Roll and KGB. So yeah, it comes from the person who does it first, and they get to kind of pull a name out of their back pocket, and that's where it goes.
One of the first tricks I learned in wakeboarding as far as flipping and rotation and going upside down was a tantrum. And a tantrum, you know, 10 more tricks start off a tantrum. You got your tantrum to fakies, you got your tantrum to blinds, you got your Moby Dicks, you got your Whirly Birds. Recently, I just learned tantrum to blind. And it's just kind of taking a tantrum to the next level and just doing a 180. You can do the 180s two different ways. You could go front side or you can go backside and land wrapped. I'm doing the harder one, the backside, landing wrap. And then if you want to do a tantrum with 360 in it but not pass the handle over the head, that's a Whirly Bird, which the Whirly, I broke my leg in 9 places on.
Dallas has really, really pushed the sport of women's wakeboarding because she's shown that the women can really raise the bar by just charging. She just charges. And I think having a big gymnastics background gave her a great aerial awareness. And she's able to take a stack and keep going. Stack is like a hard fall. And I think that's really what it takes to be a pro rider. Not only do you have to have a desire and a natural ability, but you gotta be able to take a whack and get up and try the same thing that just took you out. And she really has that.
Wakeboarding has risk and injuries happen, and I've had many injuries, back, knees, like 4 surgeries on this knee, and then I snapped this leg in 9 places, and that was the big one, and that was kind of a test to myself, like how bad do you really want to continue what you're doing, and how bad do you want to work that hard to get back where you were, because it 2 years of nonstop work and dedication and frustration. And the best thing is you learn from it, and you know, it kind of shows you how strong of a person you are to get back to where you were, and to surpass your level that you were at. And it's a test to yourself, kind of, is what I think. Like for me today, I did a dum-dum, which is more technical. There's nothing after dum-dum. You can't do dum-dum fives, or not even a guy can. So I'm pretty stoked I landed one.
For those who lack the mad skills on the water of a pro wakeboarder to attempt a double front flip or a double back roll, they can always try some radical moves from the safety of their own couch via a video game.
So a few years back, I had the opportunity to be part of a video game. And the video game was called Wakeboarding Unleashed, featuring Sean Murray. And being a kid who grew up playing video games, it was a pretty surreal experience for me, but it was a really cool opportunity. And so, they put me into it, as well as a handful of other riders. And so that was a pretty crazy experience, how they modeled us and put us into the game and took our input in the game. And being a video game, they wanted to come up with a few unique features. And one was called rope mechanics. And what that was is you could let go of the rope, do some things, and then press L2 or R2, and you'd get the handle shot back to you from the boat, and you could keep going. So yeah, that was a bit of a stretch, but we actually do it somewhat. I'll go out and do some things. I did a few things riding today where I just let go of the rope, or do a 540 and let go of the rope. It's called an osmosis five. or even just kind of pulling the rope, carved the wake a few times, and then picked the rope back up. So we have our own little version, and it is exaggerating the game, but that's why it's a video game. People a lot of times are like, man, the game is so unrealistic, you know, maybe make it a little bit more realistic. I'm like, look, come on, really, do you think that Tony Hawk can grind on telephone wires and go up to the sides of buildings and ride 30 feet in the air? And I'm like, you play Tony Hawk's game, but just because you wakeboard, like, people always give me a hard time. I'm like, look, it's a video game. If it's not realistic, go do it, you know?
Besides doing aerial tricks, riders like Scott Byerly began to explore sliding solid objects like docks and swimming platforms in the same way skateboarders began with sliding curbs and stair rails. In short order, wakeboarders began to build custom rails and ramps to hit. And because a big wake was not required, personal watercraft could now be used as the tow vehicle. In Orlando, a group of riders would create the first site dedicated to rail riding, The Projects.
Out here at The Projects, it's a wakeboard and wakeskate facility. We have 88 acres out here in Biflo, Florida, which is right outside Orlando. I started wakeboarding in 1993 on a nice pointed board. Before that, all I really did was surf and skateboard a lot. So standing up on a board, not facing forward, but sideways like surfing and skateboarding, it was a little bit natural for me. It's just different getting pulled behind that boat. I just fell in love with it, did it every day, started getting good, and you know, the guys I was riding with, they started hitting docks and rocks and shelves and whatever was floating in the water. We would go up and jib because that's what we did in skateboarding. I mean, we hit rails and things like that in skateboarding, so naturally, on a wakeboard, we decided to go hit docks. There was no rails at the time. And we started telling our pro tour, I rode up pro tour, we started telling the guys that ran it, hey, we want to put rails in, we want to put obstacles in. And they weren't really doing it, so that's kind of when a bunch of us riders stepped off and said, hey, we need to push this sport a little bit, and built our own contest. It was called the Carnival. And we put in 9 rails. We built all the rails ourselves. It was actually on this site. And after that contest, we put them all into this lake right here and decided to open up a park so that everybody can come ride them. And that's how The Projects really got was born.
Some of the guys that come out here are just amazing at what they can do. They're ollieing onto the biggest ollie rails out here. They're transferring blind, they're nose pressing down a rail, no problem. Approaching a rail can be very intimidating, especially girls in this sport are very intimidated to hit a rail. It takes a lot in the mind to say, okay, I'm going 20 miles an hour at this rail, and I'm gonna hit it. If I don't make it, I'm gonna eat it and fall. But if you get the right mindset, if you get the right ollie, if you get just the right edging, if you, the more you work at it, the easier it's gonna be and the less intimidating it's gonna be. So it's just practice and practice and practice. And it's a lot of patience, but it pays out in the end. You just, wow, I landed that trick. That's what we do it for.
You know, we started this place back in 1999, and our main vision, our main goal is to bring rails into the sport and to let the public learn how to hit rails and enjoy themselves on rails in the sport.
Along with rail riding, another alternative to boats, the cable park, would advance the sport of wakeboarding. Bruno Rixon created the first cable ski park near his home in Munich, Germany in 1962 and opened the first commercial site in Spain in 1966. A cable park uses high-powered electric motors to pull a cable around a small lake. Carriers on the cable pick up a ski rope and tow the rider around the course. This would bring a number of riders into the sport that didn't have access to a boat. The Orlando Watersports Complex has 3 lakes. One is used for boats and is a site for events like the Pro Tour and Worlds competition. The other 2 have cable systems, one for basic riding and another set up like a skateboard park. There are all manner of obstacles, such as rails and ramps and kickers, that riders can use to grind, slide, or get launched into the air to pull a big trick. Some wakeboard tricks, such as the Rayleigh and the S-bend, were first invented on the cable and then done behind a boat.
The great part about cable parks is that you don't have to purchase a $45,000, $80,000 boat. You can actually go up, buy a ticket for $23 to $26 and enjoy yourself and ride for an hour, 2 hours, 4 hours, or all day. They sell different ticket packages at parks. And you know, at cable parks, it's a system that is all electric. It's all good for the environment. You can have tons of people come there and enjoy themselves at one time. You know, at OWC, I think maybe 12 people can ride at once on both their different cable systems. They have a number of different features, different rails that people can hit, anywhere from beginners to advanced, and it really is exciting. I mean, for cable parks to go out and hit a box feature, an incline, some kickers, and progress your riding and progress your skills, it's a great place to do it, and it's very, very cost effective.
As a competitive sport, the Pro Tour for Wakeboarding has helped promote the sport by bringing tournaments to sites all over the country, like the high desert city of Reno, Nevada. Besides the action on the water, there are vendor booths for checking out the latest boats, gear, and clothing. Over the PA, lively commentary and rockin' music helps keep the energy high.
What do we got going?
Shane does an absolutely flawless bat wing after the blast, and a tail grab. You know, Shane has that just essential, awesome style, backflip transfer on that transfer box.
So side approach, nice scarecrow there.
A relaxed, casual atmosphere has the fans mingling with athletes who gladly sign autographs and pose for pictures. Many of these athletes will be the role models for the next generation of boarders.
They were out when we got here.
You hit the double up?
I killed Morning Mario.
That's awesome.
For some locals, it will be the first time they have ever seen the sport. For others, it's a chance to meet and possibly compete with some of their favorite riders in team pro-am events.
First stop on the King of Wake series is the Wake Games. It's here in Orlando. It's a pro-am event. It's one of the most unique there are out there. It's a full team event. We take the top 10 pros basically in the world. We have them pick teams, and their team is filled with a couple other pro riders and a bunch of amateur riders. So you know, all the kids, girls, wake skaters, everything get to ride with the top pros, be on their team, and compete for an overall prize. So it's pretty awesome. You know, whatever they place in their event, that there's points go towards the overall score, and everyone wants to win. You know, it's for bragging rights. The King of Wake judging is for the pro men, pro women, and junior pro men. It's a 5-judge system. You're basically looking for the most diverse riders. So we have 5 judges doing 5 different categories. You're looking for your tech, your spins, your air, your rails, and then your overall impression. So that's our 5 categories. And no matter how you're judging it, you are just looking for the most diverse rider on the water. You want a rider that's pulling from all aspects of the sports. You want to see spins, you want to see grabs, you want to see mobs, you want to see railies, you want to see it all. And that's what our judges are looking for. They're documenting it all and then analyzing who they feel won.
Another sport seen in the Pro Tour is wake skating. Wake skating has grown out of the sport of wakeboarding as riders desire to do more skate-style moves on the water. A wake skate is generally larger than a skateboard and a bit smaller than a wakeboard, typically 39 to 45 inches long and 12 to 14 inches wide. A wake skate has no bindings and often no fins. The ends and sides may be tapered up to facilitate flip tricks. A textured top, a surface of grip tape or textured EVA foam allows the board to be ridden barefoot or with shoes. The bottom is usually smooth to allow the board to release for surface tricks. Boards may be made of wood or compression molded glass over foam.
When you think about wakeboarding is when you're attached to the board and you do flips and aerials and you kind of almost recreate snowboarding in a sense. But wake skating is skateboarding on the water. So you've got a board that's set up with grip tape on the top and it's set up like a skateboard and you do kick flips, you know, and trevets and different variations that way.
It's a whole different concept than wakeboarding. It's half wakeboarding and half skateboarding. If you combine those, that's pretty much what I do on the water. And it's a lot more precise than wakeboarding. It's a lot less catching edges than wakeboarding. But it's definitely a lot of fun. If you have the patience for it, you're gonna fall a lot, but it's not gonna hurt as bad as skateboarding. It's just falling on water, and it's just a fun way to learn skateboarding, pretty much. Painless.
Wake skating came from skateboarding, and so many fundamentals of the tricks you can do, like kick flips and varial flips and shove-its and Scott Byerly saw that and decided, hey, why can't we do that on the water? If we can wakeboard, why can't we wakeskate?
Wakeskating started from pretty much a bunch of wakeboarders who got, you know, tired of wakeboarding and got bored. And they always been skateboarders, and they just took the bindings off their board and put grip tape on it. And, you know, wakeskating was born. You got your shove-its where the board is spinning either direction to where the board is spinning and not flipping, and your body's staying the same. So you go kick it out with your back foot, and when it comes around, you catch it and land on it. The kick flip is when you ollie up and you flick the board with your front foot, and it comes full all the way around like a somersault, and then you catch it and land back on it.
As wakeskating grew in popularity, so did alternative methods of getting a pull. Small cable systems that pull one rider and cost much less than a boat were developed that could be set up on smaller bodies of water.
The cable systems, it's the same way. It's one rider at the time. If they drop and fall, we just bring the handle back to them on our two-way cable, and the system too just rips them back to shore.
I definitely feel like because of cable riding, it's so much easier to go and do. There's not that much money in it. You just pay for a couple hours and then you're off on the water. And
pretty much like a skateboard park back here, but just on the water. Out here we have a box, we have a flat bar, we have a manual pad, we have an incline, and it's just, there's so many different tricks that you can try on them. There's endless possibilities.
A lot of people ask, why is it so much easier to ride behind the cable than behind the boat? And I just feel like the higher pull on the cable definitely helps a lot. If you can go and hit the obstacles there and hit the kickers and the sliders, it's much easier to figure that stuff out. You come to a whole nother world when you go and ride behind the boat. For a kicker, you have to flatten off on the cable, but for a boat, you have to stay on your edge and edge through the wake, and that's definitely a different feeling. I feel like now there's a lot more respect in wakeskating if you can do the same tricks behind the boat or like on rails or on the jet ski.
Like basic tricks, like a shove wake to wake, is not an easy trick. When a shove behind the jet ski, that's, you know, fairly easy. But you can also do a shove behind the boat. So I think the progression of tricks can go higher behind the boat because you have a huge gap and a huge wake to do it off of.
Riders without access to a lake and boat, jet ski, or cable park can still get a pull using a gas-powered winch, which can be set up almost anywhere there's a small body of water.
So the winch is awesome because you can set up at a pond, spillway, a dam, wherever you want to go, and you can do top-level tricks and you don't need a $60,000 boat.
Another sport that has risen in popularity primarily due to the ability of modern wakeboard boats to create huge wakes is wake surfing. A wake surfing board, or wake surfer, is shorter than a regular surfboard to ride in the small curl of a boat wake. Typical sizes range from 48 to 60 inches in length and 14 to 20 inches wide. Length, width, and overall shape can vary quite a bit, depending on the weight of the rider and the type of riding style. The top surface is usually covered with textured EVA foam for good grip in bare feet. Surf-style boards tend to be longer with fins, while skim-style boards tend to be shorter and wider without fins. Composition is generally compression-molded or hand-laid glass over foam.
Wake surfing is a great sport. Everybody can do it. All you really have to do is load a boat up with some weight on one side. It's usually a little bit over 1,000 pounds. Some people go higher. And you'll weight the side of the boat that you prefer riding on. Left foot forward would be regular, and that is opposite of the driver's side. And that's called regular surfing. And then when you would surf on the opposite side, being the driver's side of a boat, it would be goofy foot, and that would be right foot forward. And you would only put the weight to that side of the boat. Sometimes you'll put some in the center, etc. Basically, how you get started doing this, after the boat's properly weighted, it's a combination between weight and speed, and it will create the perfect wave. Riders will always start off learning to ride by using a rope. We'll start off with a rope, just heels on the board, get a little pressure, they'll come right up on the board. The rope's only about 12 to 15 feet long, and it puts them in the pocket, right in the wave, where it's most powerful and gives them the push. Start riding, and once they get the feel for it, then they can drop the rope. Somebody in the boat typically will retrieve the rope, and then you can free ride. You're only relying on the power of the wave to keep you up with the boat, and literally, you can ride it forever until either the boat runs out of gas or until you fall. It's a lot of fun. It's a low-impact sport. The boat typically only goes about anywhere from 10 to 12 miles an hour, depending on what style you like to ride. There are many different styles. There's the skim style, where you are going to do more surface tricks, being 360s, shove-its, etc. And then there's surf style, which is very similar to ocean surfing on that type of a style board. But our boards are all custom-made just for this sport. And the surf style boards will have more fins or traction. And that's typically an easier style board to learn how to ride in the beginning because it will track better. It's not as slippery, and you don't have the maneuverability to spin it around and do 360s and stuff like that as a novice, but the advanced riders definitely can do all sorts of great stuff.
Hi, my name's Drew Wolf. This is my daughters Taylor and Jordan. Both girls were competitive gymnasts, and that helps a lot with their balance. They like to do a lot of wake surfing where they use the ocean style boards, a lot of slashing and cutting in and out of the wake. They have fantastic balance, which really helps them to stay in the pocket, and they can ride forever.
Started out in water sports, water skiing, and it was fun, but it's very hard. And if you hit the water, you get hurt. So about 5 years ago, we started surfing, and I put up the skis, and I never looked back. Don't have to worry about the amount of strength it takes to get up like traditional skiers. And as soon as you throw that rope in, you're golden. I love it. At 51 years old, I really don't want to get hurt. And it helps me to stay fit and healthy and enjoy my life, but without the fear of a serious injury. I would rather do wake surfing than anything. I love it. I love to spend the day doing it. I like being out on the water, and you can do it all day. I mean, you can surf as long as the boat's moving. It's not like at the beach where the wave catches you, and if you're lucky, you catch the wave and you get a little ride in. You're surfing from one end of the lake to the other. It's fabulous.
I first started out wakeboarding, and then one day where I ride at Lavelle train station, I just decided to try wake surfing because I wanted to take the day off from wakeboarding or whatever it was. And immediately I fell in love with it, and then after that all I wanted to do was wake surf. The differences between surfing in the ocean and surfing behind the boat, there's two styles of wake surfing. There's the skim style and surf style. The surf style wake surfing is a lot more similar to surfing in the ocean, and then skim style is more similar to skimboarding. But the difference between the waves, in the ocean the waves have a little more power, but it's not as consistent. The great thing about wake surfing behind the boat as compared to the ocean is the wave just goes on forever, so it gives you the chance to learn lots of stuff that's a lot harder to learn in the ocean.
Whether you're looking to go big, bust a new move, or just cruise on the curl, riding sideways is the way to do it. Most skiers and boarders learn from friends and family how to ski or ride a board. While time on the water will help improve anybody's form, the quickest way to improve or to learn a new skill is to get instruction from a pro. Various clinics, camps, and schools across the country offer instruction tailored to individual skill levels. For kids, a camp setting is a great way to learn new skills and make new friends. One such camp, located on Lake McClure in California, offers a unique experience.
The unique about our camp is that we run everything off of houseboats. We're suspended off in our own private cove at Lake McClure. When the kids arrive at our camp, they arrive at our Lake McClure Barrett Cove Marina, get them all checked in, and we go pick them up by ski boat, shell them out by ski boat, come to the houseboats. Mike originally got the idea of doing camp off of houseboats because of church trips that his parents used to organize every summer. So he grew up doing that, and he just loved being on the water all week long. That summer was his favorite part of the summer. So he thought, what a better way to have a camp where you're on the houseboats. You don't have to, you know, pull the boats in and out. You could just be there, get on and off the water as quick as possible. Get them all settled, where they put their stuff away, and then we do a brief orientation, get them comfortable with the houseboat, the whole deal, introduce each other, get them comfortable, and then get out on the boats and they go do their first foundation set. So get them out wakeboarding pretty quickly. We have kids that come in here that haven't even put a wakeboard on. They're wakeboarding for the first time, never been on a boat, never been on houseboats. And then on the other hand, we have kids that are semi-pro. They've been wakeboarding like their entire lives, and they're just out here to get as much water time and best instruction possible.
Here at the camp, we focus on fundamental based coaching. What we do is we take everyone on the first day, regardless of their age or ability, bring them all to the same spot and go from the bottom up, working through fundamentals.
So first we're going to start out with the frontside slide. Show me, basically the frontside slide shows me that you're behind the boat and your balance. If you're scooting out to either side, that means you're out of balance. What we're looking for are hips rolled forward, knees bent, shoulders back, arms nice and relaxed, okay?
We have these building blocks that once they learn them can add on to tricks later in the week and make progression happen a lot more seamlessly and break down the barriers of bad habits and work up from the bottom. With a firm foundation in wakeboarding, new tricks come a lot easier. And with everyone on the same page doing tricks together on the first day with foundations, there's a synergy in the boat with among peers that you may not find with your family at home. So you find progression happening really quickly here out at camp. One of the benefits of coming to a wakeboard camp is that you have trained instructors helping you through your riding and focusing on every little aspect about your body position that maybe someone who you normally ride with wouldn't pick up on. And having that one-on-one experience with between camper and coach really helps the progression evolve that much more quickly.
What happened on that one, Stash, is you came up, you rotated your 540, you brought that right hip around, and it actually, you over-rotated where your hip was pointing towards the boat. Remember, we want to land on that switch heelside edge, so think about bringing that hip right here, pointed to 3 o'clock rather than 12 o'clock. Sound good?
Beyond teaching the kids wakeboarding here, we try to give them the most positive environment possible, where everyone's encouraging one another, just rooting for them in the boat, pushing each other in a healthy way, just getting them to land that next trick. So we really pride ourselves on just building character and building goals and helping them further their work ethic in wakeboarding and carrying it on into their other parts of their lives.
Next time in part 3 of Boards on the Water, we'll look at barefooting, show skiing, how water ski products are made, and talk with people and families that have made water skiing a part of their lifestyle.
Want more? Go to the WDSE TV15 channel on YouTube. There you'll find all 3 episodes of Boards on the Water, along with other local documentaries and programs produced by WDSE TV.